Now, today I'm going to be preaching on like the common questions about Christmas. For those of you who've been at this church since the beginning, you know, I'm sorry if this is a bit of a repeat for you, but it'll be a good reminder. I don't know, sometimes I wonder, because you know, I'm the one preaching the sermons. So when I preach on a topic I've preached on before, like I know exactly what I've preached, but then obviously you guys don't remember everything that I've preached. So maybe when I preach it again, it is a good thing to repeat things so that you're reminded of these positions. And also, you know, maybe it is time that I preach some of the sermons that I preached when we started the church, just because there are a lot of people that are part of this church now that weren't back there. Like, I remember we were talking about the sermon in regards to musical instruments. And I just always assumed Alex was there when I preached that sermon. So he knew why I believed, like, we don't have musical instruments in church. So, but Alex actually joined the church after I had preached that sermon. So you'd have to go back and have a bit of a listen. But for example, just things like that where I've preached it before, but not everyone was around at that point. Okay, so I'm just going to be talking about the Christmas tradition. Because, you know, whenever Christmas comes around, you guys know on Facebook, there's always that debate on whether or not Christians should celebrate Christmas. And there's usually three positions, isn't there? There's the Christians that are like, how can you be a Christian and not celebrate Christmas? It's like, you know, you have to celebrate Christmas and Easter, otherwise you're not a Christian. And then there are the people like me and Kev, where, you know, it's just like every other day. I don't really make a big deal of Christmas. It's nice that, you know, Australia gives us a public holiday. I don't know whether they're always that good. It's a bit socialist, I don't know, my opinion, where they're forcing everybody to close their business down. They're forcing everyone to have to pay their employees double. You know, it's great if a country wants to recognize a day and honor a day, but then don't force businesses to pay the employers more if somebody wants to work and, you know, things like that. Like, people should still be able to have the liberty in a society to run their business how they like, according to the laws in the scriptures, as opposed to just, you know, bureaucratic laws that are set arbitrarily. So that I don't like, but, you know, the fact that it does happen in our country, it just means that everyone is on break, and then it is a time to catch up on things and catch up with people that you don't normally catch up on. So since we have it, we may as well take advantage of it. But if it was my decision, if I could change Australia with the click of my fingers, you know, I would just rather it not there. I'd rather businesses be able to decide when they can go on holiday, rather than, you know, forcing a public holiday period on everybody and then forcing a shutdown period on businesses that may not want to shut down or may want to continue to run, but can't necessarily afford to pay people time and a half or double time just because it's the holiday period. So we'll start here at Romans 14. It says here, let's read from verse 1 to 6. Him that is weak in the faith, receive ye, but not to doubtful disputation. So it's things that we fight over, but are doubtful. Like we don't know. There is no clear scripture in the Bible that says whether it's right or wrong, yet people dispute over these things. That's what a doubtful disputation is. For one believeth that he may eat all things, another who is weak eateth herbs. So it associates people that are either vegans or vegetarians, that they are weak in the faith. Why are they weak in the faith? Because generally people think that they are more spiritual if they abstain from certain meats, right? So because they think they're more spiritual, they don't realize that they are who they are, or their position in Christ is determined by their faith. It's not determined by their works or what things they eat and what things they don't eat. So that's why it's saying they're weak there. Somebody is weaker in faith if they are a vegetarian and think it's wrong to eat meat. When, I remember speaking to a vegetarian once, a Christian, a supposedly Christian vegetarian, right? And I was saying, like, well, what about fish? You know, Jesus, like, cooked fish for the disciples. How can you think that Jesus is against eating meat? Let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not, and let not him which eateth not judge him that eateth, for God hath received him. So it doesn't make us any less valuable to God, but our faith is weaker. Verse 4, who art thou that judgest another man's servant? To his own master he standeth or falleth. Yea, he shall be holden up, for God is able to make him stand. And here's where we get into the days. One man esteemeth one day above another, And another esteemeth every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. And sometimes I think, you know, is this sort of linked back with verse 1 to 4, where it talks about people who think there's a distinction between different meats to eat, you know, whether you only eat herbs or whether you eat meat, and it's saying that one brother is weaker in faith, the one that thinks it's wrong to do something. It kind of makes me wonder, is it when somebody esteems a day above another, when every day really is alike, are they, which one's the weaker in faith? You know, is it the person that thinks, hey, they're all the same, just like all meats are the same, you know, but somebody thinks that, hey, there are certain meats that shouldn't be eaten, or there are certain days that should be esteemed above another. Do they have a weaker faith because they feel as though they need to be more spiritual by setting a certain day above another when all days are alike? Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. He that regardeth the day regardeth it unto the Lord, and he that regardeth not the day to the Lord, he doth not regard it. He that eateth to the Lord, for he giveth God thanks, and he that eateth not to the Lord, he eateth not, and giveth God thanks. So when it comes to celebrating Christmas, when somebody puts one day aside and says, hey, this day is a more special day, with this day we set to worship the Lord, is that something that is commanded in the Bible, or is it a doubtful disputation? It's a doubtful disputation when somebody esteems one day above another. Because why the 25th of December? Why the 25th of December is the only day that we remember the Lord's birth? We can remember the Lord's birth any day. We can worship the resurrection any day. It doesn't have to just be Easter. We can remember, and we should worship. Worshiping the Lord ought to be a lifestyle. It ought to be something that we do daily, not just, oh, wait, Christmas is coming up. Now I better clean my life up and act Christian and go to church and do something different. You know, it's a bit of a shame in our church. It's the other way around. Now, on Christmas Day, we are empty. I don't even know how many people are here. It looks like there's only about like maybe 15 of us here, including kids. You know, that the world at least understands, hey, on Christmas, Christians go to church. But see, to me, it's more about priority, right? Like, it shouldn't matter what day or what time, you know, hey, instant, in season, out of season. If we put God first, if we prioritize God, it doesn't matter what's happening, you know, in politically, or, you know, the government decides a day should be esteemed above another, or if our family decides a day should be esteemed above another, do they take priority to something that Jesus has commanded, that we are to assemble together and sit under the preaching of God's word and fellowship together? You know, there was a time in my life where I decided, you know, church was just going to be first. You know, the things of God were going to be first. Everything else has to fit around that. And, you know, in our church, it's even easier anyway, because we only meet once a week. It's only a couple of hours on a Sunday. So you've still got your Sunday morning, you've got your Saturday morning, your Saturday night to do other things. And what I have found in my own family is when there is something important on and they want everyone to be there, they won't do it on a Sunday. Because if there are people in their family that take a stand and say, you know what, it doesn't matter how important Chinese New Year is, Christmas is, Easter is, or, you know, whatever cultural background your family's from, if you say, no, they're not more important than the things of God, and on Sunday night in this church, I'm going to be at church, and you're going to expect me to be at church, so if you have something on Sunday night, I'm just not going to be there. And after a while, your family will know that. And then when they do something important, they will try and work around your schedule. So it's like, who is going to budge? Are we always the one that has to compromise? Are we always the one that has to compromise when we have the truth? We worship the true God. We're the ones constantly breaking God's commandments or not doing the things that God is pleased with in order to please our family? Or do we take a stand and make them move? You know, so we need to think about these things and think about how important, how much do I love God that I am willing to take a bit of, you know, I don't even know if I'd call it persecution, where, you know, people make fun of you. I guess it is persecution, right? When people say things, but there is much worse. You know, it's like the Bible says, we've not strived unto blood. You know, nobody's like attacking us or beating us. Words. Like Kev said last week, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. Okay, so celebrating Christmas, I think, is a doubtful disputation. There's advantages, obviously, because it's a well-known holiday that reminds people of Christ. But there are disadvantages as well to just having traditions because sometimes they become vain. Like people just go through the traditions when they don't even know what it symbolizes. They don't even have, they just do it because everyone else is doing it. Or they just do it because, you know, they're worried. If they don't do it, they're wondering what people are going to think about them if they don't do it. Like, what does the tree even mean? Like, where did it even come? Do people even think about these things? Like, why do people decorate a tree on Christmas? I know they've given meanings to the things, but why do they even do it to begin with? Do you know? So, but they just do it because if they don't, people will ask, well, where's your Christmas tree? You know, it's like people at work, they ask me, do you give your children presents on Christmas Day? And I'm like, well, you know, it's the same, is it? And they're like, well, why don't you? It's like, why should I? You know, it's just like, and people feel like if they don't, it's like they're not like loving their kids because they don't give their kids Christmas presents on Christmas Day. And it just becomes conformity without true love and meaning. So there are pros and cons. So, you know, I'm not saying it's wrong. I don't believe it's wrong to celebrate Christmas. I don't think you should necessarily have to celebrate Christmas. I am like in Romans 14, where it says here, if you esteem one day above another, another esteemeth every day alike, let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. It's a choice that we make. People can decide what they do with their time, whether or not they choose to esteem one day above another. That's my position. And then the other position is that, you know, you see it out there, people just, Christmas is pagan. Everything about it is pagan. If you participate in it or associate it with it at all, then you are following the ways of the heathen and it has nothing to do with Jesus Christ. So that's what I'm going to be talking about a bit. So is Christmas a pagan holiday? Well, let's look at the different factors that of things that people do at Christmas and see what is it about Christmas that makes it pagan? And if there are things that make Christmas pagan, then if you just don't do those things, is Christmas still pagan? Let's see. So first of all is the purpose. The purpose. Why do people celebrate Christmas? Now, if you celebrate Christmas because it's just about family, well, obviously that has nothing to do with anything spiritual. If you celebrate Christmas because you want to remember the Lord's birth, is that a pagan purpose? Is there anything wrong with setting a day aside to remember the Lord's birth? So can anyone say, hey, celebrating Christmas is pagan just because you want to set a day aside to remember the birth of Jesus Christ, to honor the birth of Jesus Christ? So there's nothing inherently sinful with honoring the Lord's birth on a specific day. Now, it's true that we are never given any commandment in the Bible to remember the Lord's birth. Right? Like we're given an ordinance of breaking the bread and taking of the cup in order to remember the death and sacrifice of Jesus Christ and his blood being shed. But we know that if the purpose of Christmas is to celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ, then it's definitely not a pagan purpose from that point of view. What about the name? So people will say that the name Christmas is a pagan name, or is pagan, and they would say, well, it's Catholic, right? Because it's Christ, the Mass of Christ, and we've associated this word Mass with the service that Catholics put on. But we don't have to explain Christ. Obviously, Christ of Christmas is Jesus Christ. But when it comes to Mass, Is the word Mass in and of itself pagan or Catholic? Or is it just something that we've associated with Catholicism and therefore we don't like the word just because it's associated with them? It's like when we think of Church of Christ, we think of Pentecostals and but are we against anyone calling themselves the Church of Christ just because Pentecostals use the word the Church of Christ? No, there's nothing wrong with the Church of Christ. The Church of Christ is a biblical word. It's a word that accurately describes something. It's the same with the word bishop. You know, we shy away from using the word bishop, and it's hard to get into the habit of using it in everyday colloquial because the Bible uses that term. But when people hear the word bishop, they think of Catholicism, and sometimes that makes us feel uncomfortable. But is the word bishop a Catholic word, or is it just a word that describes an office, and the Catholics have used it to the point that everyone associates it with Catholicism. And I think it's the same with the word Mass, because as I look up the meaning of the word Mass, what I found it to mean is it's just referring to this portion of church, which is the liturgy, which is when the preaching and the reading happens, and also the communion part, where people would partake of the bread and the cup. And in some churches that still happens, that are not Catholic churches. Like in our church, we do the bread and the cup usually separate at dinner time. But a lot of churches still, they will have their liturgy, right? They'll have their preaching and their singing and their reading. And then in that same service, they distribute the bread and the cup and they'll take communion. So that is really the Mass. And then Christmas is a Mass of Christ. And somehow people have then just taken this holiday and called it Christmas based after those two words. So I don't know whether those two words in and of themselves makes Christmas pagan or makes that word pagan. So I don't think there's anything wrong necessarily with the name, in my opinion. Now, what about the origin of the date? Because people celebrate Christmas on the 25th of December. Is there anything wrong with celebrating the birth of Christ or remembering the birth of Christ on the 25th of December? Some people will say, well, historically, the 25th of December was a day to worship the sun god. I remember I watched something recently because there's this guy on, I don't know, YouTube or Facebook, and his name's, have you guys seen him? He's called Adam Ruins Everything. It's kind of like this blonde-haired guy with like this funny, and he just goes over things and sort of gives some historical reasons and sort of debunks, you know, people that have like a belief about something. And he actually did one on Christmas. And just refuting, you know, people who say, talk about like, hey, the reason for the season is Jesus, and you know, this is why we celebrate this time. But it's not actually true. Like, the reason why we celebrate the birth of Christ at this time of the year was not because of originally a Christian reason. You know, historically it was, I don't know whether it was a worship of the sun god or Saturn or something like that, but it was a pagan festival after the Roman Empire took over and Christianity became the mainstream religion, that they then started using that day to remember the birth of Christ. That's what I understand about history. I haven't actually looked up myself. That seems to be the common understanding, is that's where the 25th of December day comes from. Because it doesn't come from the Bible. It's not like, you remember when you read the New Testament and you read Luke and you read Matthew and you read about the birth of Jesus Christ, we're not given dates. And in fact, a lot of people believe that it can't be the 25th of December because in the Northern Hemisphere, it's winter. But then they say because the shepherds were keeping their flocks out by night, they wouldn't have done that in the winter because the sheep would have gotten too cold and that sort of thing. So they say that he was probably born like in the spring or the summer or something like that. So even if the stories are true, if the history is true that Christmas came about, that the date that people celebrate Christmas came about because of a previous pagan festival that was celebrated on that date, does that make Christmas pagan? You know, so that's a question as well, because people will say, well, because, you know, previously somebody was using the day, therefore nobody else can use the day. But think about that. Is a date or a day in and of itself pagan? Why do pagans own 25th of December? If somebody was celebrating something on the 25th of December and just because of tradition that day, you know, maybe politically was a public holiday, but instead of now, you know, it's like now you have Labor Day or, you know, John, what was his name? Martin Luther King Day, where they have a public holiday, the Queen's birthday. And then we decided, you know what, we're getting a public holiday anyway, but I don't want to honor the Queen, or I don't want to honor Martin Luther King Jr. I'd rather turn it into something where we do to remember something about Jesus Christ. Can we no longer use that day just because somebody else has used that day? Like who owns that day? Why do pagans own that day just because they did something first? And who's to say that there wasn't something else happening on that day before the pagans made it into that day? So days in and of themselves are not pagan because there's only so many days of the year. Right, there's 365 days of the year, so we all share these same days, and you know, something needs to be celebrated on a specific day. So if somebody is already doing something on that day and it's pagan, therefore if anyone else does something on that day, is that automatically make it pagan now? So the day itself is neutral. You know, just like a building is neutral. You know, like, I don't know whether this building was always a Baptist Union building. I think it was probably built as a Baptist Union building. But let's say, you know, this building used to be like a Catholic church. But now, you know, because their congregation died out, somebody bought over this building and then, you know, the Baptists came in, now we're renting it. Does that make our church Catholic? Just because we're in a building that was previously owned by Catholics? No, because the building is neutral, right? The building is not pagan or Christian. It's what goes on in the building, right? And if something biblical is going on in the building, now this is a building that is used for something good, as opposed to a building used for something wrong. And it's the same with a day. A day is like a container that people do things with. If you do something Christian, it's a Christian day now. If you don't do something Christian, then it's a pagan day. Now, it's neutral. And you know what? Why not take these things back? Why not take the dates back? You know, I just posted something on our church Facebook page where Answers in Genesis, and you know, it's so sad that Answers in Genesis do preach a false gospel. They preach turn from your sins. They're good friends with Paul Washer and Ray Comfort and all those guys, Eric Hoven, all these guys that preach a works turn from your sins salvation. And it's really a shame that they've spent all this money building this ark. And I'm sure if you went to the ark and saw the plan of salvation, I bet it would say repent of your sins, because their website is all about repent of your sins for salvation, and it's just a shame. But you know, one thing they did that was interesting, I don't know whether they did it just for Christmas, but what they actually did is they lit up the ark in rainbow colors. Do you know what I mean? And if you think about it, it's so fitting, because you know, after the flood, you know, then the rainbow was put up there to remember the covenant that God made with Noah, that he would not flood the world again. It's a reminder of how much God hates, you know, sin, and he judged the world and killed all these people. And one news article actually made that statement saying, hey, like answer to the ark is trying to take the rainbow back. And we do want to take the rainbow back. It would be great where there's a day where people look at the rainbow and they say, hey, we remember why God put the rainbow in the sky. They don't see the rainbow and think perversion, homosexuality, filth, and things like that. It's such a sad thing that such a beautiful symbol of the light spectrum has become a symbol of sodomy, right? As opposed to a symbol of God's holiness and his wrath and the need to be saved. So we should take these things back. So there's nothing wrong with celebrating Christmas on a certain day. The date is neutral. There's nothing pagan about the date. But the thing is, as Christians, we don't want to be ignorant about why it exists, why it's there, because then we'll make ignorant statements about Christmas and say, you know, originally it was about the birth of Christ. Whereas historically, I think it can be proven that it's not about the birth of Jesus Christ. So we just want to be knowledgeable and not ignorant of these things. Now let's go into some of the traditions that are celebrated at Christmas. You know, what about the feasts and decorations? People say, well, you know, pagans always feast. Pagans are the ones that feast and have parties and things like that. Is feasting a pagan practice? If feasting was a pagan practice, why are there the feasts of the Lord? You know, God implemented feasts in the Old Testament to celebrate, to remember things, to symbolize things. I mean, the Lord's table is in and of itself, it's a feast. We come together and we eat and we partake of the same bread one of another so that we can have fellowship. God is for eating together, and that's why people do it, because food is central to people celebrating, to people getting together, having fellowship and catching up with one another. So are pagans the only ones that feast? Is feasting what makes Christmas pagan? So, you know, so we've looked at the purpose, the name, the origin of the date, feasts. You know, God had feasts as part of the Old Testament covenant. And, you know, people, they like to have either a honey roast ham, or they like to, you know, have a turkey on Christmas or things like that. Does that make it pagan just because people have a preference of what they eat on a certain day? I don't think so. I don't think that makes it pagan. What about decorating your house? You know, people like to decorate their house. They like to put flowers in certain arrangements in their house, or maybe they like to put tinsel up, or put, you know, hang socks on the wall or something like that. Is there anything wrong with people putting up things that have spiritual significance? You know, whether it's like, you know, a cross on the wall or things like that. I personally would be against things like the candy cane or things like, you know, the Christmas stocking, because those are things to do with Santa Claus and the elves and the reindeer and this lie and this myth of Santa Claus, which I'll get into in a moment. But, you know, this is why I would not decorate my house with those things, because of what they symbolize. But, you know, even that's something that I would do. But is it wrong for somebody to decorate a sock and hang it on the wall if they've given another meaning to it? You know, maybe the candy cane, you know, is it just that that's what's decorating Santa's house, or does the candy cane represent the shepherd's rod? You know, so who owns that shape of a hook? Do the pagans own that shape, or can that shape represent something else? Now, symbols and numbers, this is the reason why that things can so easily be accused of being pagan. Because if you think about symbols and numbers, there's only so many symbols and numbers that people can use. I mean, you think of symbols, there's a triangle, a circle, a square, a rectangle, a star, a line, you know, what other shapes are there? You know, when you teach your children the shapes, there's only so many basic shapes, and everything conforms to those shapes. Like, you look at these lights, they're circles. You look at the air conditioners, they're rectangle. You look at whatever is a square. You can make shapes out of everything. And it's the same with numbers. There are only so many numbers that every number is made out of when it comes to English, right? You know, in the metric system, 0 to 9, and then it repeats again as you get to 10 and then 100 and whatnot. So because there are only so many numbers and there are only so many shapes, this is how people that have conspiracy type websites are able to weave all these things that are unrelated together to build a narrative to look like everything is linked. You know, they'll say like, oh, you know, this thing has three circles, and if you look at it this way, it's like three sixes come together, and then you've got the devil, which is 666, and this is why this thing is satanic. Or they'll say like, oh, you know, see, and because circles are pagan and you've got balls on your Christmas tree, this is a way that people, you know, are just worshipping Satan on Christmas because they've got all these circles on their Christmas tree. But why do pagans own shapes? You know, why do they own numbers? These things are neutral, just like days, just like buildings. These things are neutral. These things are then used to, in order to fulfill a purpose. They are not in and of themselves pagan. But this is why you have to be careful when you do watch these, you know, documentaries. And I'm not saying that conspiracy theories don't necessarily exist. I'm just saying it's very easy for somebody to create a narrative just based on symbolism and just based on numbers and link something with something else when it may not be the case, and the hard facts are not there. They're just looking at a picture and saying, oh, you know, the dollar note, yeah, there's that triangle. But does that mean that any triangle you see is linked with the Illuminati? You know, no, it's just that, yeah, okay, they do use a triangle, but that doesn't mean every single triangle is satanic. Now, let's just go. So those are just some traditions I'm going through. I'll just go here to Exodus. Exodus 23:6. Because I spoke to somebody once in the United States, and they were telling me that, you know, Christmas is pagan. They were of the Christmas is pagan, you know, type of people. And he was telling me, you know, Christmas is pagan, you know, the pagan traditions and pagan date and all the things I've covered so far. And then he said to me, do you know even in the Bible that the Bible says that you shouldn't give gifts? You know, that giving gifts is a sin? And I'm just, you know, when I first heard that, I'm just like, are you kidding me? Because, you know, the gift of God is eternal life. You know, James says that every good and perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights. With him is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. So God is a God that gives gifts. So if it's a sin to give gifts, if it's pagan to give gifts, is God a pagan because he gave the gift of Jesus Christ? He gave the gift of life, the gift of eternal life? Of course not. But this is where he was going to when he talked about, hey, it was a sin to give a gift. So let's read this together and see if that's actually what it's teaching. Exodus 23:6, thou shalt not wrest the judgment of thy poor in his cause. Keep thee far from a false matter, and the innocent and righteous slay thou not, for I will not justify the wicked. And thou shalt take no gift, for the gift blindeth the wise and perverteth the words of the righteous. Also thou shalt not oppress a stranger, for ye know the heart of a stranger, seeing ye were strangers in the land of Egypt. Now anybody that, I mean, you guys may not have even read this passage before, you may not be very familiar with this passage, but just reading from Exodus 23:6-9, it's obvious that this, first of all, it's not even talking about giving a gift, right? Because it says, thou shalt not take a gift. So it's talking about taking a gift, not receiving a gift, not giving a gift. But what is it talking about when it's talking about this gift here? Is it talking about getting somebody a birthday present? Getting somebody a Christmas present? No, it's talking about the judges that were judging the nation of Israel or judging a society and saying, hey, when you judge, you don't take bribes, you don't take gifts from the people involved because it's going to pervert your judgment. And it was interesting because I was actually involved recently in a judicial selection. It's the first time I've actually been chosen to go and partake in the jury and things like that, part of our civic duty, which I think you should. You know, if you get called into jury duty, I know it's a bit of a burden just because you need to get time off work and things might be busy. And it was the same for me. Like, things were crazy at that time and I was trying to get off it. But if I didn't do it at that time, I would have had to come back like 2 months later and then it would have been in the thick of my work schedule. So you sort of take the risk. You got to go and they call you in and there's this jury selection process. And only if you get selected do you actually have to sit through the trial. Otherwise, if you go through the jury selection process and you don't get selected, then technically you've done your jury duty and they won't call on you again. But anyways, when you go through that jury selection process, part of the reasons why you can't sit on that jury or you should exclude yourself from the jury is if you know the people involved. So there, or you have a certain reason why you cannot judge as a juror impartially. So even in our law system, there are things in place that remind people, hey, if you are going to sit on a jury, because a jury has the power to nullify the decision of a judge, because there are laws in place, and then the judge then judges by those laws. So the judge is meant to be impartial and meant to look at the situation, and they're meant to enforce the laws that are put in place by government. So government passes laws, if you remember, through the lower house and the upper house, and then through common law and case law, where, you know, there are previous judgments from judges, and also statutory law, which is what the government passes. That's what a judge is meant to do. A judge is meant to sit, know the laws, and then know who is right and wrong according to the law, and then make a judgment. But the jury, what's interesting about the jury is put in place as about a check in power, where if the laws are wrong and the judge is wrong, the jury can nullify any judgment that the judge hands out. So it's sort of like the power of the people amongst their peers to say, hey, we know this person is guilty according to law. We know that the judge finds him guilty, but we think the law is stupid, or we think the judge's judgment is wrong, so we will not find him guilty. And if a jury finds the defendant not guilty, it doesn't matter what the law and what the judge says. They're let off of all those charges. And I think there's a law about double jeopardy as well, where you can't be charged for the same law. So once they're acquit of those charges, they can't be brought again for the same charges. Where was I going with that? So what I was saying was, even in our law system, we have ways where we are trying to encourage impartial judgment. And that's what this is about. This is about people having impartial judgment so that when they judge a case in the Old Testament form of government, that the judgment is not perverted and we don't rest the judgment of thy poor in his cause. And it's the same today, right? And this is why, you know, part of the qualifications of being a bishop is you have a good report of them which are without. And that could mean people outside the church or people that don't have a lot of money. You need to be friends, not just with people that are prosperous, that have a lot of money, but people that don't have a lot of money too, because you need to remain impartial. Because sometimes things will come up in the church, you know, you don't want to be greedy or filthy lucre, where you have to do something But then if you are buddy-buddy and dependent on all this money from some rich deacon in a church, then you might not make the right decision and judge impartially. Okay, so, you know, people that believe, hey, it's pagan just because pagans give people gifts, they are not looking at the whole picture that, you know, giving a gift is just a way that you can express love to somebody. And God expressed his love to us by giving his son's life for us on the cross. Now, I'll just go over this list quickly, but, you know, here are some problems with Santa Claus. Because one thing I do not like about Christmas, and I'm sure you guys all agree with me here, is people celebrating Christmas with Santa Claus, reindeer, the elves and stuff. And you know, what really bugs me is when Christians that ought to know better, like Christians that ought to know better, get involved in these things. And you have, you know, bishops of churches wearing Christmas hats, you know, Santa hats, getting their kids dressing up as elves. And you know, I don't know whether they're decorating, you know, their church building with reindeer and snow and all this stuff. And you just think, what has that, you know, if you're going to celebrate Christmas and you're meant to celebrate Christmas because of the birth of Jesus Christ, what has that got to do with a fat man in a red suit delivering toys around the world on Christmas Eve? It's got nothing to do with Jesus. It's like Christians that celebrate Easter. Okay, if you want to celebrate Easter, that's fine. I'm all for Easter. I probably like Easter more than I like Christmas. But if you're going to celebrate Easter, why would you do it about the Easter bunny and egg hunts and do all these things that have nothing to do with Easter at all? That, you know, when it comes to the Easter egg and the Easter bunny, those things probably are pagan. You know, when it comes down to celebrating the fertility god and all that sort of stuff, if you believe that history, Why would Christians be involved with Santa Claus at all? You know, and I feel as though, you know, shame on the parents that are promoting not only the Santa Claus narrative within their family and telling their kids that, oh, you know, on Christmas Day, oh, look at all the parents' presents that Santa brought us on Christmas Day or on Christmas Eve. Why would you lie to your kids like that? Why would you lie to your kids about where the presents came from, that there's this imaginary guy living up in the North Pole? Because you know what's going to happen when you lie to your kids about Santa Claus, you lie to your kids about the Tooth Fairy, you lie to your kids about the Easter Bunny? You know what they're not going to believe you about when you tell them? They're not going to believe you about Jesus Christ anymore. They're not going to believe you when you tell them about God and you tell them about the cross, you tell them about heaven, you tell them about hell. Why? Because you've been lying to them your whole life. You lie to them from the cradle up until they're, you know, a teenager, and then you wonder why when they're teens they just don't listen to their parents anymore. Because their parents have just been lying to them their whole life about all these different things, and they just realize, oh, it was just you all along. So was God ever blessing me? Do you know what I mean? Was it ever God? Because it was always you when you said it was Santa Claus, when you said it was the Easter Bunny, when you said it was the Tooth Fairy. Maybe when you say it's God, it's just you. And now that I'm an adult, I know it's just me now. Now they just become a humanist because they realized everything was just you, as opposed to you differentiating for them, hey, everything comes from God. And that's why I have anything at all. But, you know, what are the problems with Santa Claus? Here's a list that I've compiled. Number one, it's a lie. It's not, the story is not even true. And, you know, if you're going to educate your children about Santa Claus, at least educate them that this is something that people teach their children. It's something that people talk about, but it is not true at all. And we need to educate our kids and don't lie to them. The other problem with Santa Claus and promoting it within your family and even churches promoting it with their church and decorate is that you are promoting the Christmas industry. Dude, the more Christians buy, you know, the Santa hat, the reindeer, you know, headbands, the elf shoes, or whatever you're buying to do with this lie, the more they're going to make them. That's why at Easter, I never buy Easter eggs, because I'm not going to spend my money promoting an industry that's promoting a lie. You know, I'd rather buy things to do with Jesus and buy things and spend my money wisely. I'm not going to promote this vain merchandise of Santa, elves, and reindeer. What about the fact that, you know, the way that they promote Santa as though he knows whether you've been bad or good? You know, omniscience, which is something, is an attribute. Omniscience is when you are all-knowing. That's an attribute that is reserved solely for God. God, only God knows everything. Even so, you know, a lot of people think that Satan is like this anti-God, as though God is the white version and then Satan is like the black or red version, and they're sort of like yin and yang, like they're opposites and they both have equal power, like in, you know, in the Roman mythology or the Greek mythology, where you've got Zeus, he's like the white good God, right? And then you've got is it Hades? Hades is the god of the underworld, and he's like the counterbalance of Zeus. No, no, Satan is a cherubim. He's a created angelic being. He's a created heavenly being that sinned against God and is basically leading the charge of the rebellion against God. But he is not a god. He wants to be like God, but he is not everywhere. He is not all-knowing. But this is what people paint this picture of Santa Claus as though he is omniscient. As he knows whether you've been bad or good. He knows all your sins, and you better be good for goodness sake if you want to get presents from him. What about, this is number three, what about the promotion of children to write letters to him asking for things? It's almost like we are teaching our kids to pray to this imaginary being in the North Pole by writing letters to him. And these letters are not letters to bless other people. Right, when they're writing letters to Santa, it's all about writing a list of all the things that they want. I want this and I want that. And this really, this is one thing I really don't like about Christmas and birthdays. And even my wife and I were talking about it. Like, this is one thing I don't like. I don't like the materialism. And I don't like the attitude that it gives kids that, hey, it's Christmas. What are you going to give me? Hey, it's my birthday. Gimme, gimme, gimme. You know? Well, what's in it for me? Where's my gift? Just because it's on a certain day. You know, where now the heart of the matter obviously goes deeper than that, but that's one thing that is a problem, where, you know, this promotion of children to children just you know, getting whatever they want on Christmas as opposed to working for what they want. Okay, so that's number three. Number four is, you know, like I said, promotes materialism. Number five. Santa, he can be everywhere at once. You know, the story that he can deliver Christmas presents across the whole world on a single night, almost taking up that attribute of God that he is omnipresent, that he is everywhere at once. And just like I said about Satan, Satan is not omniscient. He's not omnipresent either. He's not everywhere at once. Satan doesn't know your thoughts. You're like, Satan can't hear your prayers. Do you know what I mean? Unless you're saying them audibly. That's why this idea of the Pentecostals, that you need to pray in a different tongue, otherwise, so Satan doesn't understand you. No, you just need to not pray out loud, and then Satan doesn't know what you're praying, right? Because he can't read your thoughts. If you just pray to God in your head, Satan has no idea what you're praying. But Satan, he just knows the human nature. He knows how to tempt man. That's like we see that in the Garden of Eden. He knew the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. He knows these things. And that's why he knows how to be so influential. And this is why he's so good at running the Hollywood industry, the media industry, because he knows what makes the flesh tick. And he knows how to capture people's attention and get them doing things out of pleasure rather than out of sense. Number six, Santa is fat. He's a fat man, so he's not even a good role model of good health. Do you know? So if somebody, like, they call him, you know, Father Christmas, which is another problem, right? Call no man father. We call him Father Christmas, and he's a fat father. That's not something that, you know, I'm not having a go at anyone who's a bit overweight. But I'm just saying, hey, you know, if you're overweight, you know, that's not healthy. It leads to a lot of health problems. And, you know, when we talk about role models, we're not saying, hey, you know, look at this obese person. That's what I want to be someday. Usually they're used as a bad example to say, hey, look at what happens when you don't look after your health, you don't exercise, you don't take care of yourself, then you will put on weight. And generally it's people that, you know, maybe they have a disability. So not everyone who is obese is because they intentionally want to be that way. Sometimes people are disabled, sometimes they have issues with their body, and because they cannot move, they start to put on weight. So, but that's not Santa. You know, Santa's not disabled, right? You know, he can work that workshop, right? And he can work those reindeer, climbing up and down chimneys and whatnot. Why is he still fat, right? Maybe he's eating too many cookies or something. You know, he's eating all the cookies every time he goes to the house. It's undoing all that hard work he's doing. So number 8 was the sinner being referred to as Father Christmas. And the 9th one I've got is, you know, he lives with a bunch of little boys. You know, he doesn't have any children himself. You know, he's married to Mrs. Claus, but, you know, hey, sodomites were married also, weren't they? So he's living with all these little children. You know, they are forced to work under a socialist regime because who's paying, like, where does he get all this money from to even, like, pay, you know, to look after all these elves, making all these gifts? So there's a lot of problems with Santa Claus, and it really boggles my mind why any Christian would want to be involved, you know, when they celebrate Christmas, why they would want to promote Santa Claus at all. You know, whenever Santa Claus comes up in my family, yeah, my children know about Santa Claus, but I don't even think I'm the only one that does it, because I was at work, like, just this week, and, you know, this week people are bringing in their kids, you know, like they bring in their kids and maybe because school holidays are over, right, and they don't want to pay for daycare. So then they bring their, the moms bring their kids in, and they might work half a day. And I was overhearing somebody, because one of the employees said to this kid, like, oh, like, is Santa Claus bringing you presents this Christmas? And he's just like, no, Santa Claus is a lie. But it's just funny because, I'm not the only one that's teaching my children that Santa Claus is a lie, that he's basically another type of Satan that's just pretending to be God, but he's not the true God. So, my kids know about Christmas, they know about Santa Claus, but every chance I get when they see it, we'll remind them that Santa Claus is not real, that it's just a lie that parents teach their children, it's a story that people celebrate or that people use during Christmas that has nothing to do with Jesus Christ. All right, the last one I just want to cover is the big one, which is Christmas trees. All right, Christmas trees. Because one of the big things that people really hate about Christmas, especially the Christmas is pagan crowd, is, this Christmas tree. Now, I didn't put this Christmas tree up. You know, this, obviously we're renting a building here. So it's funny because Kevin actually was talking to me about, oh, should I cover up this drum kit? Because people were saying that they look at our pictures, our photos on the internet, or they look at our videos. When before I used to take the whole stage, but now I only want to get the screen up there. People would see the drum kit and the speakers and things like that. And if they didn't know much about our church, they would think that we were rocking it out like before and, you know, using all that equipment. But, you know, obviously this is not ours. That Christmas tree is not ours. I don't have a problem with the Christmas tree. But people who are of the Christmas is pagan crowd, they would accuse Christians that decorate a pine tree as setting up an idol and worshipping an idol. So let's just talk about that for a moment. Is decorating a tree for Christmas idolatry? Right? Is doing that, is that idolatry? Is that what the Bible would define as idolatry? And does anyone that does this, did they commit idolatry? Like did Punch Bowl Baptist Church, when they set up this tree, are they like pagan idol worshippers now because they have this decorated tree in their auditorium here? I don't think so. That's not my position. But there are a lot of people that make that accusation. Now, why is a Christmas tree not an idol? Well, let's go, first of all, to Exodus 20. We'll look at this, Exodus 20, verse 4. At the commandment of the second commandment, which is not to make an idol. So what is an idol? Let's look here in Exodus 20, verse 4. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. So that's the second commandment, that to not make
any idols. And you know what? I don't even think when people say the second commandment is to not make any idols, that they are actually quoting the whole commandment, right? Because most people, when they think of the second commandment, they only think of verse 4, don't they? They think verse 4 says, thou shalt not make make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is heaven above and the earth beneath. So they say, look, see, so if you make any statue at all, any graven image, that's idolatry. And they'll say, yeah, that's why the cross is an idol, because you are making an image of something that exists in the earth, a plus sign, right? And that's an idol. Or they'll say, like, the ichthys fish, right, that some Christians put on the back of their car. They'll say, see, because it's made of metal, that's a molten image of something in the earth, that's a fish, and therefore that's an idol. Is that the commandment in the Bible? Is that idolatry? So they'll stop at verse 4 and say, look, you just can't make anything. But that's not the whole commandment. The whole commandment is to not make the graven image. And then it goes on to say that not to bow down and serve the image. So idolatry is not just creating a statue, right? Or creating an ornament of something that resembles something that exists in the world. Idolatry is when you create it and then you bow down and serve it. So, yes, is a cross an idol? No. But if somebody looks to their cross every morning and kisses it and says, oh, this cross protects me, and, you know, like, they're worried about what's going to happen to the cross because they're serving it, or they think that if they don't do something, then the cross is going to curse them or bless them, then it's become an idol. That is idolatry, because they're bowing down, they're worshipping it, they're serving it. They think that it has some sort of power, like it's a god, as opposed to just creating the cross as a symbol of Christ's love, you know, because he died on the cross. You know, he died on the cross, and that's why Christians love that symbol of the cross. And it's so interesting, the thing about the cross is that, you know, when you give somebody a symbol of love, you don't buy them like a mini guillotine, do you? Like, you buy them like a little guillotine to hang on their necklace, or, you know, like you have like a little gold noose, right, that's like hanging on your pendant, because these are instruments of capital punishment, right? Instruments of capital punishment. But because Jesus died on the cross commending his love toward us, it's interesting that the wooden cross, which is an instrument of a brutal death, has become the symbol of unconditional love. You know, it's an amazing thing. But So what I'm getting at is, you know, the sin of idolatry is not just making the image. And why do I say that? Well, I don't have these verses in my notes, but there are times where God actually commanded graven images to be made. So if it was a sin just to create the graven image and that was idolatry, how could God, for example, command Moses to build the brazen serpent? You remember in the Old Testament that they were getting bitten by fiery serpents, and then he commanded Moses to make the fiery serpent, the brazen serpent. And Jesus actually refers to that story in John 3. He says, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. So that brazen serpent actually represented Christ being lifted up on a cross. But Moses was actually commanded to make that brazen serpent. Now, if it was a sin to make a graven image, how could God command Moses to make that graven image? Right? How could God command Moses to make the Ark of the Covenant? If you remember, where he made the two cherubims made out of gold, their wings overshadowing the mercy seat of the Ark, representing the Ark that was in heaven. And this is something that God commanded. This is the tabernacle in which he was worshipped. Even Solomon, when he made the temple, he put, you know, many statues in there and things like that. And God blessed that house. And he went and he symbolized himself by dwelling there. How can it be a sin to create a molten image when God is actually the one commanding them to make it? And is part of how they worship him. So, yeah, if somebody worshipped the cherubim itself, that would be idolatry. But creating the cherubim is not idolatry. And that's actually, if you remember what happened with the brazen serpent, that is actually what happened in the Bible. They created the brazen serpent. He lifted up. Anyone who saw the brazen serpent was healed of the fiery serpent. But later on, the nation of Israel actually took that brazen serpent, called it Nehushta, and actually worshipped the brazen serpent. So that's when it became idolatry. It became idolatry when they actually started bowing down and serving that molten, graven image. And that is what God is against. So when it comes to a Christmas tree, is it an idol in the full sense of the biblical term, in the sense that is anybody bowing down and worshipping the tree? You know, like, yeah, okay, somebody decorates a tree, but first of all, it's not even a graven or a molten image, right? Because a graven image is something you carve. A molten image is something you melt down and you blacksmith or whatever they do. So they work that metal, right? But when it comes to a Christmas tree, I mean, what are we carving? They're not even carving the wood. You know, they're cutting down a tree. Like, most Christmas trees are already in the shape of that triangle. They're just cutting it down and putting it in their house, no different to any other pot plant you have in your house. And they're not making anything out of metal either, unless maybe some of the decorations are made out of metal. But nowadays, you know, it's too expensive to make things out of metal, so it's all plastic and paint. So most Christmas trees nowadays, it's not a graven or a molten image. They're just placing a tree in their house. And number two, it's not even a sin to have a molten or a graven image, first of all. You know, people have statues of elephants in their house. Is it wrong to have a statue of an animal in your house? No, it's not. But the problem with the Hindus is that they take those statues of those elephants and they worship them. They think there's power in them. That's the problem with it, not the fact that somebody's just made a statue of somebody or something. Now, I definitely agree that it's not biblical. You know, there's no commandment in the Bible to make a tree and decorate a tree to remember the birth of Christ. But that doesn't mean it's wrong. You know, there are many things that we do. You know, you can have a family tradition that is not necessarily wrong to do, but it's just something that we do. It's like birthdays. You know, Jehovah's Witnesses will use the case, well, birthdays aren't in the Bible, therefore it's pagan, therefore it's sin. Is it wrong to celebrate birthdays? Is it wrong to celebrate anniversaries? I don't see anniversaries in the Bible. You know, you see marriages, but do you see anybody celebrating their marriage many years later as an anniversary party? And nobody does. We do, because we just do things, because we like to have traditions. Man has traditions to remember things, to honor things. It doesn't necessarily make it wrong. And it's the same. Somebody might have an activity where they bake a cake. Like in Mexico, they bake these different cakes, and these cakes mean different things. Whereas, you know, in American society, they decorate a tree, and Australians just copy everything Americans do. They can't think up of their own traditions. You know, that's why, you know, they think, what am I going to do on Christmas? They decorate snow and everything. We don't even have snow here. We have a guy in like a really hot suit. You know, so then they have the, I was telling my wife, and she's like, what does Santa do in Australia? Well, he wears a t-shirt and sunnies and shorts, but it's still like the red and the, you know, the white fur and everything. But it's the Australian Santa Claus when he's on vacation, right? So, you know, at best, it's a family activity that may be a way for children to remember certain things. Because I know, you know, the star on top, they'll say, is the star of Bethlehem that the wise men followed, and then the gold represents, you know, the gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and the tree might represent new life, you know, so people can give meanings to this activity just as a way to remind their children, hey, you know, this is how to remember things. And it's no different to just what people do in like Sunday school classes, where they create activities for children just to help children to remember. Or, you know, we have songs and action songs to help children to remember. You know, my God is so big, so strong, and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do for you, right? So, you know, we teach our children these things just to help them to remember biblical truths. But does that mean a Christmas tree is an idol in and of itself? I don't think so. Now let's just go to Jeremiah 10, because this is the passage where people will go to say, this is the Bible showing that they did decorate trees in the past, and it's a pagan practice, and God is telling us he wants us to have nothing to do with it. Jeremiah 10. So let's read here in Jeremiah 10. It says here, hear ye the word which the Lord speaketh unto you, house of Israel. Thus saith the Lord, learn not the way of the heathen, and be not dismayed at the signs of heaven. So they say, see, this is what the heathen do, this is what the pagans do, and this is not what we want to do. For the heathen are dismayed at them. For the customs of the people are vain. So a custom is just another word for tradition. For the customs of the people are vain. For one cutteth a tree out of the forest, the work of the hands of the workman with the axe. They deck it with silver and with gold. They fasten it with nails and with hammers, that it move not. They are upright as the palm tree, but speak not. They must needs be born, because they cannot go. Be not afraid of them, for they cannot do evil, neither also is it in them to do good. For as much as there is none like unto thee, O Lord, thou art great, and thy name is great in might. Who would not fear thee, O King of nations? For to thee doth it appertain, for as much as among all the wise men of the nations and in all their kingdoms, there is none like unto thee. But they are altogether brutish and foolish, talking about the idols. The stock is a doctrine of vanities. Silver spread into plates is brought from Tarshish, and gold from Uphaz, the work of the workmen and of the hands of the founder. Blue and purple is their clothing. They are all the work of cunning men. But the Lord is the true God. He is the living God and an everlasting King. At his wrath the earth shall tremble, and the nations shall not be able to abide his indignation, his hatred, or his wrath. So, as we read over that, maybe for those of you who are not familiar with this passage, we might have read through that, and you're like, oh man, that really does sound like a Christmas tree, right? Because you just once read over it, you say, yeah, they're cutting a tree out of the forest, you know, and then they're decking it with silver and gold. Isn't that what we're doing here, like this Christmas tree? Like, they've cut it out of the forest, or a representation of the tree, right? So they haven't even cut this one out of the forest, because this one probably bought from Kmart or something, you know? So they bought it from Kmart, but it's like it looks like a tree that's cut out of the forest. And then they, you know, deck the halls with boughs of holly, right? And they deck it with gold and silver tinsel. Is that what Jeremiah 10 is talking about? Well, let me give you four just points in here that I'll just point out why this passage is not talking about this activity here, where people have taken a tree. You know, some people will take actually a real tree and then decorate it. That's not what Jeremiah 10 is talking about. Now, the first one is in verse 5. I mean, even verse 4, right? This is an extra one I'm just thinking of now, where it says in verse 4, they deck it with silver and with gold. I mean, most people don't even put real silver and real gold on the Christmas tree. Like, they're just representative of silver and gold. But this is saying, this is not saying they deck it with things that look like silver and look like gold, right? These people are actually putting silver and gold on this thing that they're making, because they're trying to make it of value. Whereas this is just for visual purposes. You know, nobody's putting real gold and real silver. Otherwise, there's no way they'd leave that Christmas tree there, right? Because if they put real gold and real silver on it, I mean, that tinsel would be worth thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars. So they're not even putting real silver and gold on it. They fasten it with nails and with hammers, that it move not. Christmas trees are not fastened generally with nails and with hammers. They're planted usually in a pot if they're real, or they're just on a plastic stand. You know, they're just sitting there. They can be moved around. So nobody's fastening it with nails and hammers. Verse 5, they are upright as the palm tree, but speak not. Now, when it says they speak not, doesn't that mean that whatever they're making probably has a mouth? Because, I mean, what has the Christmas tree got to speak out of? Let's say you believe that a Christmas tree could speak, I mean, but it doesn't have a mouth. Whereas with an idol, usually it has a mouth. You know, like it's an animal with a mouth, or it's a man with a mouth. But so it tells me what they're making. It's probably something with a mouth. But what's interesting about verse 5 is it says they are upright as the palm tree. Now, if you're going to compare something to a tree, it's probably not a tree to begin with. Right? Like, it's like saying, like, Kevin, he looks like he's like a man. But it's like, well, duh, because he is a man. Like, you know, it's why am I comparing Kevin to a man when it's like a Christmas tree. Why would they say they're upright as the palm tree when they're already a tree? Of course they're going to be upright like a tree. They're a tree. So whatever they're making is not a tree, because if it is a tree, then it's not going to be compared to a tree. Does that make sense? So, they must need to be born, they cannot go. So that's number one. It's a tree, so it obviously can't be talking about a tree. It's designed to be carried, right? Because it talks about they must needs be born because they cannot go. But a Christmas tree is not really designed to be carried around. Like, when you think about idols that are designed to be carried around, you think about the Catholics, right? The Catholics with their statue of Mary, And, you know, they didn't even follow this commandment properly, because the commandment says, hey, you know, nail it down so that it doesn't fall off your thing that you're carrying it on. But, you know, you see those YouTube videos where they're carrying their big statue of the Queen of Heaven, and then one of the old guys, like the thing falls off their shoulder, and then the statue just comes crashing down, and everyone's like, oh no, our God is broken on the floor. I always find those videos so funny. They're like the sort of videos you can watch on Facebook, and you know, they just keep repeating. You just like watch it a few times. It's like so funny. But you know, they're not nailing their idol down so that it doesn't move off the platform that they're designing for it to be carried on. Nobody's designing a Christmas tree to be carried around. Generally, they're put in an area and then they're left there, and they're left there for months after Christmas. You know, I knew like some families where, you know, they took so long to take their Christmas tree down that they just left it up all year and just redecorated it again when Christmas came around again. So that's always funny. So that's two things. What's another thing? Let's go down to verse 9. Verse 9, it says here, silver spread into plates is brought from Tarshish, and gold from Uphaz, the work of the workmen and of the hands of the founder. Blue and purple is their clothing. So you see how whatever they're making here in Jeremiah 10 has clothing. But nobody puts clothes on a Christmas tree. You know what I mean? Like you put tinsel, you put decorations, you're decorating this tree, but you don't put a t-shirt on a Christmas tree. Like you don't put pants on a Christmas tree or a robe on a Christmas tree. And it says here, they are all the work of cunning men. So what they're making here is something that requires skill to do. But a Christmas tree does not require skill to decorate a Christmas tree. And this is why when families do it, their kids get involved. Their kids throw on the tinsel and hang the balls on there. And it's a family activity that is done by unskillful people, right? As opposed to when they're making this idol, they're making this graven image or this molten image and decking it with gold and silver. That actually requires some craftsmanship, some skill to actually create this idol, as opposed to just throwing some tinsel and decorations on a Christmas tree. So there are four things I think there's probably other things that I've missed, you know, but I've given you about four to six things. Why Jeremiah 10 is obviously talking about idolatry and creating an idol where people are creating this thing of value to worship and serve it, not just decorating a tree, and nowadays even a fake plastic tree, as a family activity to remind them of the birth of Christ. Now, the last thing about this tree is people will say, oh, you know, the Bible talks about groves. You know, they worshipped in the groves where they would plant these trees and worship in them. But when did a single tree become a grove of trees? You know, like people, they take one tree, they decorate it, and now all of a sudden it's a grove of trees, you know, that they're worshipping. So number one, nobody's worshipping around the tree. Nobody's bowing down to the tree. It's one tree, and it doesn't even require skill or anything that this passage is even talking about. So Jeremiah 10 is not talking about Christmas trees. You know, many people decorate trees, not even for Christmas. I think the tradition, I'm not 100% sure, you know, where it started and why it even caught on, but, you know, I know people decorate trees all the time, you know, just to make them look fancy. So it's probably just a tradition that people did, but they just wanted to give it some significance and some meaning to remind remind their children about spiritual truths. So let's just end on this point. Let's end on John 4, where Jesus talks to the woman at the well and says, "The woman saith unto him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." So what's the moral of the story as I talk about these things about Christmas? Is, you know, don't be ignorant. You know, yeah, if you're going to do an activity Don't just do it because that's what you've always done. That's what my family's always done. It's just a tradition and we just do it. You don't even know what it represents, why you do it, where it came from. But if you're going to do something, hey, know why you do it. Don't be ignorant, because we ought to be not just worshiping God in spirit, but also in truth. And this is why I would encourage you to put away the Santa merchandise, the Easter Bunny merchandise. Don't lie to your children. You can't worship God on a day and honor Jesus Christ on a day when you're telling your children lies about Santa Claus flying around on reindeer, delivering presents, when every good gift comes from above, from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. All right, hope you learned something there tonight. All right, let's pray. All right, thank you, Lord, for your word, and thank you, Lord, for just a reminder of, you know, if people are going to celebrate Christmas, why they ought to celebrate it, what they should be in teaching their kids about you at this time during Christmas. I pray as well, Lord, that we would not condemn one another if we esteem one day above another, or we esteem every day alike. I pray, Lord, that we just be fully persuaded in our own mind. I pray, Lord, as well, that you will bless our time together as well at dinner. And Lord, we pray that you'd help us to worship you in spirit and in truth. And Lord, we would not promote lies in the world and lies to our children. So thank you, Lord, for giving us the truth. Thank you for giving us the spirit of truth. And I pray, Lord, that you'd help us to discern what is right and wrong so we can raise a generation that loves and serves you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.